working.
Thank you. Good evening, folks. Welcome to our regularly scheduled meeting of the Town Council of March 6, 2017. Jody, if you could lead us in the pledge, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Dolores?
Counselor Bello.
Here.
Counselor Hammond.
Here.
Counselor Hurley.
Here.
Counselor Latina.
Here.
Counselor Martino will be late. Counselor Rell has a conflict tonight. He won't be here. Counselor Spinella.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Barry.
Here.
And Mayor Montaneri.
Here. Thank you, Dolores. We have a pending proclamation for the Health District, which I think our Health District is either just running behind, so we're going to move by that. And before we go into public comment, I know many parents and interested parties are here to hear a little bit about the football field, share their thoughts on the football field. I know there was a story this evening on it on the news, which probably inspired a little bit of attendance, which is great. I did ask our town manager in advance of public comment to give a brief summary on what's happening with the football field, you know, what the status is from the town's due diligence, so we can share that before folks weigh in on it. Just it might help, I think, provide that accurate information before you and we certainly are happy if you want to chime in and comment. Well, that's why we're here, of course. But I think because this has come on the screen more actively in the last month or so, I think it's helpful for Jeff to share what exactly is happening with the field and what our due diligence plans are. So if you can indulge him for 10 minutes on that, and then we'll go into public comment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As we spoke, or as the mayor spoke, the football field is an item of discussion in the community now. And just for some history, when we are currently completing the high school renovation, which was an $85 million project, $44 million of which is paid directly by the town of Wethersfield. We knew going into the project, we meaning the council, the capital improvement advisory committee, the building committee, and the board of education all knew that once the high school project was completed, the next task was the replacement of the turf on Catone Field. That was always the plan because it wasn't part of the renovation for several reasons. So over the past year, as the project has come to almost an end, we get some work to do this summer, the conversation has started about replacing the turf. And earlier this year, the Public Works Committee of the Town Council met and talked about what do we need to ask, what questions need to be had. There's issues with, you know, the concerns about the use of the turf and the infield material. So we gathered information on that. We had conversations with the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee just in the last couple weeks, who recommend projects to the Town Council for their budget purposes. And they recommended the council move forward with replacement of the turf. The biggest hurdle we face as a community in the replacement of this field, it's somewhere between $700,000 and $800,000 to replace this turf. Okay. Now, the town's capital improvement budget, entire budget for capital improvements that covers both town facilities and Board of Ed facilities, is $900,000. So if we were to pay for this all in one lump sum, there wouldn't be any other project out there, any money for any other project out there, whether it be on the town side or the board side. Okay, so some kind of opportunity to use a payment plan as we did when we put it in would make sense, and that's what the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee has recommended, that we undertake the same type of financing plan that we did when we built the field in the first place, which isn't unreasonable, and it is a viable option. Okay, now we are now, when we put together next year's budget, we have issued three series of general obligation bonds for the high school project. One series for $22 million, one series for $11 million, and the final series for $8.5 million just this year. So if you kind of look at the trend for the current year, we raised the tax rate for the second series of bonds. Last year's budget had the first series of bonds in it, and it's cumulative, so it's not, you know, one done. You get 20 years on each series. And next year, we have the final increase in our budget for the debt service on the high school. Well, we will be adding $800,000 of new money required to make the debt service on the high school. Now, the debt service will peak at that point for the high school project. And over time, as the debt gets paid off and older debt gets paid off, though that amount necessary to fund debt service in the town will go down. So the challenge is, how do you mix in other projects of substantial size to this other $800,000? Or last year it was close to $1 million, and the year before that it was $1.2 million. Right? So that's been our challenge, and that's why we knew once the high school project would kind of worked its way through the budget system, it would be, we would have the opportunity to address the Catone Field turf, come up with a plan, meet with the stakeholders, and get this done appropriately and without really impacting the taxpayers and compounding the issue of the debt service of the high school with other big projects. So that's kind of where we are, and that's kind of the process we've worked through the wintertime. We've met with the athletic director of the high school. We've met with capital improvements. We've talked to different turf companies, and now it's time to have that conversation about what are we going to do with the field, i.e. what infield material, now that we're moving the girls softball field there, is that a special turf? Is we have to do something different? All these different questions to be answered, come up with a plan, come up with a financing mechanism, and undertake the project. And that's kind of where we are now. Whether that takes place this summer or at the latest next summer is really the question. We know, we've always known, that this field will be replaced. It's never been an issue, and I've not heard any council member ever say it's not going to be done, or any Board of Education member or anybody else. It has to be done because we're not going back to grass, right? That doesn't make any sense. So at this point, we're working through a process of what needs to be done, who are the stakeholders, what level of improvement, what kind of infill, and then coming up with a financing plan where it doesn't compound an already challenging budget season with another big project. Because again, the high school renovation was the single biggest public works project this town has ever done and will be the single biggest public works project this town will ever do until we do it again 22 years from now, right? It just is. $44 million, which more than doubled the amount of debt the town carried, okay? Now, the financing plan we put together for the high school was spot on. Now it's time to work that through the system and then digest it and then move on to Catone Field so we can plan for it appropriately, finance it appropriately, and manage those projects as we go. That's kind of where we are, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Jeff. I appreciate that summary. And I also would just add one other piece. We've done a little discussion, obviously, with the council over the last month or two, and it's obviously getting on the screen now because people are paying attention to our decision-making for the budget process. So I will share with you that I really believe the sentiment on the council is that this is much more likely to be urgent than deferred. But one of the things that's on the screen that we have to put our arms around, and I think quickly, is the time frame to get it done. So taking the turf out, repairing the undercarriage, and making the soil decisions and combining it, all of that would have to be done before the season starts if we do it this summer. So we're at the point in time in terms of our due diligence that the time frame is also got to be answered, so we do not risk having a field that's not ready for a start of a season. So I want to be sure that parents and football players and families that are very interested in our town, I'm sure I shared this both with the council and some of the other folks, that we completely appreciate that parents want to see this happen, if at all possible, this summer. We're very aware of the issue of any safety question. Obviously, that would be paramount in our mind. I believe our physical services people, along with the athletic staff, have had some of those discussions. And certainly, if there was any inference that there's a safety issue on the field, and we haven't gotten all that due diligence in front of us just yet, obviously this council would make the appropriate expedient decisions to take that off the screen. We don't want any of our players hurt. I will remind people, though, that when we did the turf field, I think it was 11 and a half years ago that the field was put in, and those of you who may have been here, I was certainly aware, that the grass field that we had was very prone to injury. There were a lot of players that were getting hurt on the grass field. There were pieces of sod that would come up. The drainage was really poor. And we've certainly looked at this field versus our other grass fields, including Webb, and are aware that, in fact, it's according to the folks that we obviously are looking at and getting this information, it's still considered in decent shape. It's safer than grass by a large margin. And that's not to suggest that that urgency isn't on our screen. It is. So, again, by straw poll, I think it's fair to say that this council is very aware that it's of the utmost importance that we make a prudent decision. It will be part of the budget process in the next 30 to 45 days. And I will say to you, for what it's worth, and I appreciate that we have a large crowd of people here, and I'm happy to have 100 people come up and speak to us tonight, but I can tell you, you don't need to assure us of the safety issue, the urgency. We're very aware of that and just want to make sure that you know that we're operating with that perspective. Because I think sometimes we've had two meetings in a row with different topics where some of the information out there, people may not know that we're aware of what you're thinking and concerned with. And I've also met with a couple of the parents who have been very active on this topic and have assured them that this is a very important topic for us as a council. And I can't imagine once that information is finished, and I think in the next few weeks, that we won't make a decision that absolutely takes into account your sentiments. Obviously, we don't want any of our athletes to put in a position of any concerns about safety. All of us have been there, I think, with kids that are important to us. So I want to make sure we share all that, and happy to take public comment on that or any other topic. So I'll open up public comment, and if folks want to speak. Mike.
My name is Mike Orsini, 224 Highland Street. Thank you, Jeff and Paul, for that. One of the things I want to bring out here is the thought of misinformation. And we know misinformation gets through our system, and people take things the wrong way and get information, whether it's through a friend or through Facebook or whatever the case is. Council members, I do want to say, I do understand that every month you're faced with a different dilemma in this town. And you have to know 1 month about buildings, another month about roads, another month about fields. And I respect that. One thing I do want to make clear is that I want to give you a little history in regards to Catone Field with the turf part of it. I was involved in the process of when the field was getting done. When the RAD company came and they dropped that shovel, I was there. I was there from the time they dug it till field turf came, laid the turf. I saw the whole process. At that time, there were only three other people in the town of Wethersfield that saw what I saw and had the knowledge that I had. That was Jay Catone, who at the time was the athletic director, Jim McDonald, who was the head of the public works, and Marty Sittler, who was the advisor or the supervisor at the time of the rec department. All three of those have now retired, and that leaves me. I can't speak for any other fields except Catone Field, only because if you look on the internet, you can't compare apples to apples. When the field was going from year 9 to 10, and let's just make this clear, Catone Field, when it was installed, had an 8-year warranty with a 10-year lifespan, okay? So between years 9 and 10, I went to the rec department, spoke with Marty, and asked him about having a refurbish done to the field. What that would do is, even though the town does own a piece of equipment that combs it out. What the refurbish does is it takes the particles from the end of the field and brings them back. For people that don't know about the particles, those are the black things you see the kids kick up. They would literally cut up some of the field and put it underneath. This would have cost between $40,000 and $80,000. With that said, Marty advised me it wouldn't be a good idea. It's probably not going to happen because we were in the early stages, the very early stages of thinking about doing the high school. And maybe that would have got put into the equation. I understood. It's dollars and cents, and I understand that. So this past summer, I approached some council members by phone and in person because I didn't want all this. And I made it perfectly clear I didn't want to bombard this place. And I talked to them about the concern about the field. Not that I'm a professional on the field, but I know what's going on with it. They all advised me to go to a council meeting, which I did in September. Going to the council meeting, I put my concerns out, and about a week or two later, I spoke to the council members that I had originally spoken with. They said I did well, it sounded good. They were all in agreement, like you did say, that it's something that has to get addressed and get done. I got the no problem. So it was no problem. So parents now, during the season, we're going October, November, are asking me, how'd you make out at the town council? I said, everything seems to be going good, everyone's on board. If things go good, and it's always a budget thing, which I understand, it should be able to get done for the upcoming season. Okay, so everyone's happy, we're going good. After Thanksgiving comes, now there's a development. Now we have to make sure in Wethersfield that the field we get, make sure it's not cancer-causing. Make sure the fibers aren't cancer-causing. Make sure the actual grass that you see is not cancer-causing, which I understand, okay? And one of the things, like Mr. Bridges did say, someone brought up, well, what if you took the field, dug it out, and put the dirt and grass back in? Which is ridiculous, but you know what? You have to cover all grounds. So we go from there. Again, you haven't heard or seen from me since. 2 weeks ago on a Tuesday, there's a meeting here about MDC. I'm not even going to go there with it because I wasn't here for it. The next day, and this gets back to my misinformation, the next day I receive 22 emails and 7 phone calls, all saying, what's going on with the field? Wait a second, you tell us now we can't do it, but yet we want to put money somewhere else. I don't know the information. I don't know what's going on. I did not have the answer. So what I explained is that our town manager can only do so much. He can only spend so much. If it's not there, can't do it, and no one wants to have taxes go up. So I was advised to speak with a couple of parents, and we sat down and met with Paul Montaneri, our mayor. He came, was very nice. We had a great conversation. He bounced a lot of questions off me. He did have a question I couldn't answer. The question that he had asked me was, if you remember, that as the field ages, is there a statistic of how many more kids get hurt? And you can't give an honest answer to that because I really don't have the data, and I don't think anyone else has the data. You remember. Mm-hmm. So I was really thinking about it, and again, I don't want to make this sound the wrong way, but I just want to give an example. Because if you're not an athlete, or you're not a parent of an athlete, what I'm saying makes no sense. Kids are going to get hurt. It's part of the game. Whether it's football, soccer, cheerleading, it doesn't matter. But let's say, for instance, hypothetically, 20 kids get hurt on that field last season. This isn't a fact. I'm just saying it. So let's say because of the age of the field, 50% more were to get hurt next year. That's kind of a broad number. That'd be 10 more kids. 30 kids, that's stretching it. Let's say there was one child. Let's say that number went from 20 to 21. Let's say that one child gets hurt. We could look at it statistically and it says one child. Let's say that one child gets a concussion and they're out of school for 6 weeks. Or that child tears an ACL. Well, it's part of the game. Is it part of the field? You don't know. But my point is, what if that's your child? Or your child, then it's a fire drill here. So I don't want to make this a political thing. I don't want to make this Democrat, Republican. I don't want to make this into, well, if they vote for this, we'll vote against whatever the case is. I know Mr. Bridges is going to try his best to try to make it work. And if he can make it work for this year, that's great. That's a positive. I just don't want any of these kids out here to suffer the consequences, either without a field or a field that's not suitable enough. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mike, and I appreciate that summary. I think I would also share, I appreciate you took the time and have taken the time on the topic, so hopefully that sentiment is shared by all. Thank you.
Hello, Melissa Whitaker, 179 Griswold Road. A little shorter here. I have four children. Victoria is a junior at WHS. Jake is a freshman at WHS. Luke is in sixth grade at Highcrest, and Zach is in preschool. My family is here to show our support regarding the replacement of the turf to the field at Wethersfield High School, like many other people. All three of my older kids currently use Catone Field. Victoria is a high school soccer player, Jake is a school football player, and Luke as a youth football player. And Zach, well, he'll be playing on the third round of turf, or hopefully not, because I heard this round of turf will last much longer. So it'll be cost effective, right? That's what everybody wants to hear. I can stand here as everyone else and go over all of the reasons that this field needs to be replaced. But to me, it's not something that I feel we need to convince you of. I can't imagine you don't agree with this, and from what you said, it sounds like you do. It's something I feel is common sense. It's the oldest turf field in Connecticut. Should have been replaced in 2012. It's now 2017. Wethersfield is better than that. Our kids deserve better than that. We've created this beautiful, amazing, state-of-the-art high school. We have high standards for our kids. That is the standard I expect from Wethersfield in all areas, education, athletics, as well as our fields and our buildings, and I think you all do too. I think it is time, obviously beyond time, to bring this field up to the high standards we have set in this town for the safety of our kids, if nothing else. I know most of what I am saying and that we will all be saying is going to be repetitive, but this is what we all have to do as citizens, repetitive or not. We need you to hear our voices. We need you to know how strongly we feel about the replacement of this turf as soon as possible. Over the past few weeks, my children, my husband, and I have attended numerous town council, board of ed meetings to show our support for turf replacement, lacrosse programs at WHS, the DECA program. Although I can admit there are many other things I would rather be doing with my time, and I'm sure all of you would rather be doing with their time, it's important that we show our children how this democracy of ours works. You are all sitting in those seats because we, the community, decided that you were the best people to represent us. The people we felt would listen to what we had to say, listen to what mattered to us, and do right by us. And I'm pretty sure by now you have figured out that this field matters to our community. We need to show our children democracy in action. We need them to see that what we say matters, what they say matters, and that their voice can make a change and that you are listening. I know that this is a financial matter. I know deep down you know this is something that has to be done. It's something you all want done. It all comes down to money. That's where you come in. This is your job to problem solve, to figure it out. I have confidence in you. I believe you're up to the task. There's always a way, and I think you are all willing to try to find it. Please make this happen for our children for this year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Lisa Puglielli. I live at 15 Quail Hill Road. I'm here tonight to ask you to please release the MBR money to the Board of Education so that they can grant funding to some very deserving students and the programs that are in jeopardy without this money. I went to the Board of Education meeting last week to speak on behalf of the DECA Club at Wethersfield High School. This is a business and marketing club for juniors and seniors who are interested in pursuing a career and or a college degree in the field of business. I explained to them how the DECA group has put in hundreds of hours of work this year into projects that they are presenting at a state competition next week. The top three finishers in each category at the state competition then earn the opportunity to travel to the national competition and represent Wethersfield at a national event. They found out a little more than a week ago that the funding for this national competition was being cut, so that even if they did win a spot in the competition, they would not be able to attend. The cost of the trip for the students is paid for by either the students themselves or their families. The only cost to the school is the cost of the chaperones to go and guide them on the trip. This amount is less than $4,000. With this funding cut news so close to the competition itself, again, the competition starts next week, there was no time to fundraise for this. They could not raise the money themselves. At the Board of Education meeting, many of the kids that are involved in the DECA program, and there, a lot of them are here tonight, spoke about how the program gave them direction for further education, for their future, for their career. It gave them an inspiration with going to college or going into the workforce. Students who had been to the competition last year spoke about the impact it had on their lives. They were very passionate, and honestly, they were very inspiring. There was not one Board of Education member, and honestly, there was not even one spectator in the audience who did not agree that such a small investment of $4,000 was money wisely spent and that these kids should be getting this experience. However, the board said that there was nothing that they could do about funding this project unless the town council released this MBR money to them and that we should come and speak with you tonight. So, here I am. I'm here to ask you to please release this money. I don't honestly understand this issue. I don't know much about this issue. I don't know the back and forth that has gone on before today or why it hasn't been done sooner. But I do know that whatever is preventing this issue between our Board of Education and our town council is now having a direct negative impact on our students and the children in this town. So I'm asking that the adults here please find a way to work together today so that the politics stops adversely affecting our kids. DECA needs at least a verbal okay by Wednesday, which is in 2 days, if they can go ahead with this. Please, let's celebrate the remarkable achievements of our students and show them the pride that our town has for their accomplishments instead of making them a victim of our town politics. Please release this funding today so that the superintendent can grant permission for these kids to have this experience. That's my thing on DECA. As an aside, in addition, I also want to say that I'm in complete agreement with all these people that are here for the TURF. I think that we have invested money and time and effort and blood, sweat, and tears into all these amazing buildings and fields, and it would be a shame if we didn't maintain them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Abby Sullivan and I live at 62 Fairlane Drive. I'm here to speak on behalf of the Wethersfield DECA funding. My DECA partner is Sarah Puglielli, she's here tonight, and our project is the Financial Literacy Promotion Project. The goal of our project is to educate the community on the importance of managing and understanding your finances, which we believe is a very important skill, especially in this day and age. As a part of our project, we went to 3 sixth grade classes at Highcrest Elementary School to do a PowerPoint presentation and a day in life game that we created. We also did this for a Boy Scouts of America troop in Wethersfield and at the Rocky Hill Teen Center. In addition, we presented at 3 local businesses and created Instagram and Twitter accounts with the handle Own Your Finances. We also had to write a 30-page report, and as well as other groups too. Sarah and I, and everyone else involved in DECA, have worked extremely hard on our projects since September. I'm a 3-season athlete, as well as a member of multiple clubs. Fitting DECA into our busy schedules was a challenge, but we always made time on the weekends to fit it in, completely outside of school. The leader of DECA, our teacher, Mrs. Riccardi, has put hours upon hours of her own time into helping us make sure our projects are perfect. We found out that the funding was not going to be available just over a week ago. If we had known earlier, we would have been able to fundraise and collect the money ourselves, but that is unable to happen now, with the state conference so soon. I ask you to please consider the work put into these projects and the benefit they have to the school and the community. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for getting up.
Austin Bovino, 86 Valley View Drive. Good evening. I am a junior at Wethersfield High School. I am here to speak upon the issue regarding DECA funding. My partner, Blake Fulton, and I have spent countless hours on weekends, after school, and nights after swim practice learning all types of material that could be in our presentation or in preparation for the state conference, which is on Monday, March 13th, so it's just a week from today. Historically, Wethersfield DECA members have been extremely successful at the state level and have been invited to participate at the national conference. In addition, I have been selected to represent Wethersfield High School as well as the state of Connecticut at the national conference as a state representative and officer of the DECA club. Unfortunately, due to the current budget freeze, we will not be able to take advantage of this prestigious opportunity to attend the national conference. The DECA National Conference is an enriching experience that cannot be replicated for our WHS DECA members in any other way. I respectfully ask for you to consider unfreezing the funds necessary to send us to the national conference. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Justin Bianchi, and I live at 31 Stillwell Drive, and I'm a junior at Wethersfield High School. I am here advocating for the DECA Business Club that I am currently a part of at the high school. The DECA Club recently lost $4,000 of funding needed to attend the national competition in April due to the budget freeze that was enacted by the Board of Education last year. DECA is a business and marketing club in which students create projects to present at the state conference, which this year is being held next Monday. My partner and I, along with the rest of the students in the club, have been working tirelessly on our project since early September in hopes that we will make it to the national conference in California. We found out 2 weeks before the states that we had lost the funding for the chaperone's expenses for the national trip. Had we found this information out sooner, we would have been able to fundraise and find other ways to come up with the amount of money needed for the trip, but now that is just not possible. After bringing our request to the Board of Ed, we were told that they needed the money allotted to the board in the form of the minimum budget requirement in order to grant us the funds. We are now asking that the Town Council fund the Board of Ed in the form of the MBR so that we can receive funding for our trip. As a junior, this will be my first year being a part of the program, and it has already helped me in so many ways. My partner, who couldn't be here tonight, wanted me to include how much DECA has helped her with her career choice and how much of a learning experience it has been for her. A chance to go to this conference would mean the world, and a chance to stand with so many people who have put in as much work as us would probably be one of the best experiences. Now, there is no guarantee that my partner and I will make it to nationals, but our chance for our classmates who have put in so much work to do so would be amazing. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Hello, Town Council. This is a shame.
You need to give name and
address. Greg Leishatz, 221 Walker Hill Road. Brings tears to my eyes. Here's what I'm going to do. These kids don't get the money on Wednesday. I'm going to cut a check for the DECA for $4,000. So if you don't step up to the plate, I'll cut you guys the check. You know where I am, 221 Walker Hill Road. Come and see me. I'll give you the check. Do something with the field.
Do you want to pay for that, Greg?
Listen.
We'll take a check right now on that.
How about this? No, I'm not going to. I'll take care of the kids, but also you got to take care of their health. My son's playing football and all these kids and everybody else is going to be.
Thank you, Greg.
All right?
Yep.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Colleen Keene, 99 Wells Road. I have three kids in Wethersfield school system. Two of them play on the turf for football and soccer. We are here today to ask for the placement of Catone Field because of the risk of the injury to our athletes. As most of you know, it was installed in 2004. There's an 8-year warranty and a 10-year lifespan. Almost after 14 years of uses on the field, the sand underneath, as many of you guys know, the field is made up of basically a huge sand pit. And through the time of all the usage, it's hardened down, it's been packed down, and therefore it's kind of become a cement substance, and it's become a potential injury to our athletes. And the fill that's in between all the grass fields, or in between all the grass stuff, the black pellets, have gone to the side. And if you ever pulled up the side of the turf, you would see them on the outskirts near the cement along the outskirts. If you took the time to walk the field, you would see that all the divots and all the lumps throughout the field. What are we waiting for somebody to get hurt? Potentially, this field could be deemed unsafe. Then what happens to our athletes? They're farmed out to practice at other fields, and all of our home games would be away. This is leading to an extra expense to our town, not only to transportation, but also potentially renting a facility so our kids can practice. The girls and boys soccer team, the field hockey, and the football team. Away football games, we'd be transporting not only the football players, the band, the cheerleaders, the dance team. The white buses would not be able to accommodate all these kids, so it would be an expense to our town getting DATCO. And we all know what the issues that we had with DATCO this past year. It's a huge expense and a huge issue waiting to happen. Off-site practices is a huge issue. A three-hour practice turns into a four-hour practice with the transportation. I saw it firsthand with the girls' swim team this past fall. My daughter's a swimmer. These kids need to get home to study, to study and to do homework. Potentially, the loss of this field is not only just to Wethersfield High School, it's also to the youth programs. It'll affect not only just the athletes, but to our boosters and to our athletic department, a loss of income for the home games, and the town will also lose revenue from the outside organizations renting out our field. Why do we have this beautiful field? We have new bleachers, a great new viewing area, beautiful new brick wall and entranceway, but yet our main attraction isn't safe and isn't usable, potentially isn't usable. Wethersfield High School has one of the first turf fields that were put in, but yet now it's the oldest. All these other schools around here have put in turf, but yet have replaced them since then. 14 years ago, we knew this would potentially need to be replaced, so here we are asking for this to happen. Mike Rossini has done his homework and has spent a lot of time to set up the best way to lease and finance this project. If we act now, we will be able to have a safe field for our kids. The safety of our youth should be at everyone's first thought in their minds. Lastly, most of these athletes here are potentially seniors next year, and they've been playing football or soccer or whatever else since they were 4 or 5 years old. They've been waiting to spend their senior year on Catone Field and their senior night. Why are we intentionally probably taking that away from them? Please move forward and let them have their field next year for the safety of our children. Please replace the field for 2017 fall.
Thank you, Kevin.
I'm Craig Elliott, 46 Blueberry Hill. I have played football, organized football, for almost 10 years now, going back to Mighty Mites. Over that time, I have played on countless number of fields in many towns throughout the state. In all those games, I have never experienced any type of head injury till recently. 2 years ago, I had a concussion, which happened on our high school field. I was out for only 2 games. Last year, I also sustained a concussion, this time fairly severe. I was out 6 weeks and ended up in the hospital. This one also took place at our high school. After the coaches reviewed the film, we found out that this injury occurred not by contact with another player, but it occurred when my head made contact with the field. The impact of my head hitting the field caused my concussion. I believe we all realize that football can be a violent game and that there is a certain risk involved, but shouldn't we at least make the effort to reduce the damage as much as possible to make the game as safe as possible for all of us? Thank you.
Thank you, Greg.
Matthew Silver, 23 John Elaine. I know that you've said that you understand that the field is not in the best quality, but just from a mentality of someone who plays on that field, I wouldn't call it a fear when you step on the field, but I will say that it is all in all of our minds that when you get on that field, there is a risk, not only of other players, but of the field when you hit the ground. I know that when you're walking down that pavement trail to get to the field, and you step down onto the turf, there's not much of a difference other than the minor step down. It's very compact, it's very solid, and like I said, it's just something that everyone thinks about, and it just may be impacting us in our future.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing.
Hello, John Cathcart, 53 Peach Hill Road. I was involved with the athletic field being replaced in 2004. I was the chairman of the committee that the council assigned at the time, and it was a tough go to get it to where it was back then. You had a lot of people that didn't want to put it in, but now that it's been put in and it was successful, everybody here wants to see it continue to be successful. I also had an ACL injury playing on the junior high school field when I was a kid, so I know how it is going in your senior year, being worried about getting injured. My background was a tennis court and running track construction, and I did put in about 10 of these fields. The technology's changed, and I'm not in the industry anymore, but I'd be certainly willing to help again if necessary. You certainly want to know what you're getting, because like Colleen Keene said, the turf is, it was like almost two and a half inch blades of the synthetic grass, and they're supposed to be about a quarter inch thick. If you look at any of them now, the technology was, as it breaks down, those blades of grass splinter, and the rubber and the sand infill is supposed to, you know, the rubber is supposed to be your cushion. The original turf fields that they had back before all these had a rubber base underneath the turf when you had the AstroTurf back in the day. They eliminated that by putting this rubber infill and having the longer blades of grass. This field, as the stuff disperses, you lose that cushion. So what's happening, and that's why everybody's complaining about the problem with how the concussions, is that there is no cushion anymore as that compacts. We have, I think the town has whatever it's called, the blade, the spinning thing. I don't know if they've ever used it. I've never seen it in action, but that was meant to be able to add rubber over the years and disperse it back into the center of the field. So I think that's part of the problem, but I think it's been more than 11 years. I think it's 2004 that field was put in. So, you know, I just want to be here in support of it. Obviously, you have other people in support of it. And, you know, if there's any way we can help, you know, we're here.
Thank you, John. Thank you for your service. Stoppy, how are you?
Stoppy Manusis, 136 Windmill Hill. I have a couple kids that went through the school system. One is a current junior, or a sophomore, I'm sorry. The other just graduated, both played soccer. I'm also president of the Wethersfield George D. Ritchie Soccer Club. So we've been, the club has had a lot of increased registrations, increased use of the fields. We've been very committed to supporting Catone Field. I think the problem is we have a first-class complex in that whole stadium, probably in the state, but we have a second-class field itself in the turf. It is very uneven, and I'm sure I'm repeating a lot of what some other people have said already. It's very uneven, which causes a dangerous condition. The seams are starting to come apart, and it needs to be replaced. Now, I can tell you, I've, as you know, I've sat on that side of the table before, and what I think you can do is, if there really is a will to fix this, I think we can find a way. I do support the leasing option, which was done in the past. It's an easy way to finance it, and it makes economic sense, I think. So the soccer club and I would support replacing that field as quickly as possible. I know there's budget concerns, but again, if there's a will, I think there's a way. Thank you.
Thank you. Stop me.
Good evening. Luke McCoy, 416 Slater Road, New Britain. I'm actually a landscape architect with a company, Castle Booz Associates. I also happen to sit on the board of directors for the Synthetic Turf Council. It's a national organization surrounded by synthetic turf, everything that has to do with it, infill, landscape, all that. I originally came tonight just to kind of listen to what your schedule was, because this is the type of work I do, design, oversight of these types of projects. But while I was here, I heard that you guys still have some outstanding questions you're doing some due diligence on, and just wanted to offer anything that I can help as you do that. One of the things that, because I sit on that board of directors, I'm unbiased, so I'm not tied to any manufacturers, any infill, any of that. I'm not allowed to be, otherwise I couldn't sit as a board of directors member for that. So I can provide you with information that's not based on a certain manufacturer or any of that, but just industry-wide. So I'll be glad to leave my card. If I can help with anything behind the scenes, you had some questions about how long does this type of a project take, things like that. I've done dozens of these types of field. I can help give you guys info as you need.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Other folks wishing to speak? Lee?
Good Lee Seekus, 117 Wells Road. I'm here for another reason, but in regards to the field, I'm for it and against it in a way. My mother never let me play tackle football. My doctor wouldn't let her. Risk of injuries way back then, and now it still exists with a safe field, without a safe field. But better have a safe field than an unsafe field. As far as Steve donating $4,000, God bless him. We need more community, civic participation. That's one thing I want to talk about that's coming up on next Wednesday for people who use the Dollar Ride service for the elderly and disabled. Less than a week and a half ago, it was decided there'd be a meeting next Wednesday at the Pitkin Community Center at 3:30 with the Social Services Department, the Curtin Transportation Service that the town has, and any comments and concerns and are welcome from users, future users, or family members of users, because there always are concerns with Dollar Ride services no matter where you go. Another thing is $4,000 is a nice donation. If we all donated a little, just think. We can knock that $800,000 down to a couple $100,000. The Danger Center, this is one other thing I want to mention, is having a fundraiser dance on Friday, April 28th. This is trying to get more interaction between young and old. We have a lot of young here, and we have older people here. And we're not calling it a sock hop, we're calling it a cyber hop. It's going to be a combination of young DJ, and it's going to be fun. There'll be some refreshments, and it's going to be $20 a ticket. And I'd like to say, anybody who wants to come, support. Don't forget, the more you support us, the more we can support you. That's what neighbors are supposed to do, help one another out. Teamwork is the best way to get things done. And I'd just like to say good luck with all the things. And if interest rates are going up, get that loan for the field, so interest rates will be a little lower than it could be come a couple of weeks from now. I thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Nice to see you. Other public comment this evening? Cindy?
Good evening, Cindy Zerbalis, 119 Two Red Highway. I have no paper tonight, so I wasn't planning on coming up here, but And I want to thank Mayor Montaneri for coming out and meeting with Mike and I. He's been really, really helpful. I guess the only thing I really want to come up here and say is I'm a football mom. My son plays on that field. He comes home. He tells me what the field's like. He came home like a couple weeks ago because he's out there running the field. Because he wants to be the one making the touchdowns. But that's why he's practicing his running. And he's saying, there's divots in that field. It's in bad shape. And I guess what I'm really saying is, if we can, and I know all you guys want to replace the field. I know you all care about kids. I've known many of you for many years. I know you care about the children. I know you want to do right by the children. I know you want to do right by the town. I know all of you do. But I guess as a mom, as a football mom, I'm saying, please, if we can do this, it needs to be done this year. We can't wait. We cannot wait. And I know, the whole safety thing and everything you guys are questioning. Listen, it's not in good shape. These boys are telling us they're getting off that field, they're getting beat up. And I've also talked to numerous refs that have told me when they go on that field by the end of the day, and these are older guys, they're saying their knees are killing them, their legs are killing them. You spend some time on that field for a couple hours for a game, and they're in pain by the end. So I guess all I'm saying is, a football mom, please take care of my baby and make sure our babies are safe. They are our babies. I don't care what anybody says. Thank you.
He doesn't look the slightest bit embarrassed, Cindy. Other public comment this evening? Bob?
Good evening, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I see you have a new speaker here, and I think that's good. Let's see how it works. I was around 14 years ago as well when they spoke about putting turf on the field, putting lights on the field and the financing that went into it. And the citizens that said they were going to finance it. And how much did they pony up for the lights? $30,000. And the state taxpayers picked up the rest. The state taxpayers pick up a tremendous amount of costs connected to our school system and to our town, but especially our school system recently with the renovation of the high school and all these other things that are all the ECS money coming in. And my issue is that, yeah, maybe the turf now is tired. But on the other hand, there should be a bundle of money on the sideline to take care of this renovation of the turf. You've been collecting revenue from the gate receipts for how many years? 13 years? 13 seasons? There should be a pile of money sitting there. You were supposed to rent it out for certain organizations or whoever wanted it for dollars. I don't know how much they got. I have no idea. But I did look into it a few years ago with the town manager, and there wasn't a heck of a lot that was collected for having a first class rated by the town of Wethersfield stadium. You collected very little money, and you had very little to show for. And talking to the town manager tonight, he says it's all on the shoulders of the Board of Education. You're the ones that are supposed to collect that money and hold on to that money and do it as a business. For when something needs to be replaced by turf, the money should be there. And is it there? Nobody knows. Only the town Board of Education knows. And I think they should step up and tell us how much money there is there. And I believe we then should have an accounting of our people on the Board of Education, how good business people they are. Because from what the manager has told me, there's not a heck of a lot of money there. Where did it go? We originally got that turf put on the field by going out and borrowing money. That money that you collected from the gate receipts and concessions and whatever else you had, you should have been saving it for this day. And only the manager or the chair of the Board of Ed can tell us how much money is in that account and how much is available. And we shouldn't really have to borrow a nickel. This is a first-class rated stadium that millions of people were supposed to come to, and that's what we were sold on. And our businesses around here, we're going to flourish and do a tremendous amount of business with all these stadium events going on. We should be flush with cash. Instead, we're broke. Broke because of mismanagement. Board of Education should report to us at their next meeting how much cash they have from collections. Year by year, they should put it out on the website. We should see what it is. We should also see what expenditures came out of that. Taxpayers should only pay once for that turf. The rest should be pay to play. And if we don't do that, then we've created what they call eternal life. Well, the religious term, eternal life, that's what you have here. Eternal life of borrowing money. And we'll borrow and borrow forever and ever. And that's exactly what we have here now. Now, tonight we also hear, and I heard from at the board meeting, the DACA group needs money. We heard about soccer people, or I should say lacrosse people, need money. And we need all of this ponied into the Board of Education. And we pony, as citizens, tremendous amounts of money into the Board of Education. And who are the people who are getting served? We have about 3,600 students. We have a town that has 26,000 people. And out of that, the minority is getting the majority of the cash. And that's not right. The rest of, especially the other people who don't participate with the school system should be getting something more than just the bumpy roads that we have and the garbage pickup. We should be getting a lot more. Tonight also was mentioned, the MBR. I spoke about the MBR a number of years ago and have talked about it only on occasions. Now it looks like there's a little cash flow coming in because of, and I don't understand what's going on with the MBR, but the fact is that money should be invested into or reduce our tax bills. That's what that money should be used for. We shouldn't be using it to spend it on other programs like free spenders, because that's exactly what some of these people would like, including our superintendent. He wants to be a free spender of everybody else's money. And it's got to stop, Mayor. I know I may be one of a few that got up, maybe I was the only one tonight that got up here and spoke about in a negative way about this, but we cannot keep spending the way we're doing. And we cannot keep spending on the minority. We got to take care of the majority. And a third of this population in this town are senior citizens on fixed incomes, and whatever kind of incomes, they're not doing too great. And those people are paying for all these luxuries that are being asked for. And you folks are the ones who are going to make the decision. And in doing so, I hope you will say no to these additions. We should go back and see what the Board of Education has in cash, and they should be ponying it up. And we should go back and look at all the receipts to make sure that we didn't miss any money, because that money that we get is money we don't have to go out and borrow.
Thank you, Bob.
Yes, I know. Thank you. You know, Mayor, there were other people that got up here and talked for quite a while, too. But because I have other issues that I'd want to talk about.
I'm sure it'll be back.
You know darn well I do.
I look forward to it.
Thank you very much, Mayor.
Thank you.
Hello. My name's Connie DiGiacomo from 270 Brimfield Road. I'm here today as a parent and also as the Wethersfield Football Booster President. I have three children who've been through the school system here and have used Catone Field through the years for youth football, travel soccer, and most recently the high school football team. As I mentioned, my husband and I are currently the Wethersfield Football Booster Presidents, and we're here representing the football team as well as in particular, my son, Ro, who is a junior at the high school right now on the team. Our son, as well as all the other players, utilize the field 4 months out of the year. And as his parents, we feel his safety is a concern. On September 23rd of 2016, he was injured during a football game on Catone Field. It was a non-contact injury where his knee gave out for no apparent reason. As a result, he was out of commission for most of the season and had to have surgery to remove a torn piece of his meniscus. He didn't return again until the Thanksgiving Day game, which was at in Newington on November 23rd. We believe that the status of the turf could be a contributing factor to his injury. There's no reason a healthy boy without any knee problems should have this happen to him and have him miss his entire season. He loves this sport with all his heart and soul. We're lucky that he recovered and he was able to play again. He aspires to play at the college level, so we just want to be sure that he is safe, doesn't sustain any further injuries, and we would worry that he could lose his senior year or potentially even have permanent damage. I'm here to urge you to support the replacement and the proper maintenance of the turf to protect our community and the kids that come to use our field from other towns. Turf fields are not meant to last forever, and we are all past the point where this should have been replaced. The proper maintenance of the field should have been contemplated when we invested in it. It is a great field. We have a lot of different activities that happen at it. I believe it's your duty as a town council to ensure that the resources that are available for our town children and people to use are properly maintained for the safety of our citizens, as well as the safety of those that come to visit our town and play on our fields. Thank you.
Thank you.
How you doing? I'm a little taller. Anthony Petrizzo, 50 Stillwell Drive, Wethersfield. I remember the day my son Michael, who's since left Wethersfield, stepped foot on that field in a youth capacity in 2004 with DeVos kids. The field was really nice. And it's considered some wear over the years, but here we are. I'm in support of redoing over the field. I'll keep it short. And let's get it ready so we could play against Newington and beat them again. Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak this evening? Public comment? Okay. Thank you for all of your comments. I'm sure many of you echo the comments that were provided, pro and con, I suppose. Thank you. Council reports. Council reports this evening. Jody?
I was unable to attend this meeting, but I did want to report back from the note, the Wethersfield Advisory Committee for Persons with Disabilities. They discussed going through some programming issues with the lunch program, but our town manager was able to solve the problem, and that lunch program will continue, so we thank you for that. The seniors are holding their spring cleaning, which will be May 11th at the Pitkin Community Center. Dial-a-ride costs have been going up, $350 per ride, so that will be discussed with the vendor at the next meeting, which Lee talked about earlier. That'll be on the 15th at 3:30 at the community center. And there was also discussion over the resource book being updated, so that's a project that the committee will be taking on over the next few weeks.
Thank you, Jody. Tony?
I filled in for the deputy mayor at the building committee meeting last week, and Christine is here tonight to speak on behalf of the issue we've got with the architect. We went over everything last week. They went through the reasons, and we had gotten an email in the meantime as to why the additional costs were in there for the architect. And there was one item they had tabled on there for a change order, which was for redoing one of the floors in one of the rooms, one of the locker rooms, but they decided that it wasn't worth redoing that floor because we looked at it and there were some chips, but the chips now aren't causing a problem, but by the team using it, there's scratches, so if we redid it, we'd have scratches again, but we won't be affecting the integrity, so they've canceled that change order, which is adding another $37,000 to the contingency account.
Thank you, Tony. Other council reports, Amy?
I attended the library board meeting last week. The library board approved the director's budget of around $1.9 million, and that'll go to into the town manager's budget. It was about an $18,000 increase, so it was a very reasonable increase in the library budget. April 1st will be their library book sale, if anybody's interested in attending that. And they are beginning to initiate a strategic plan. I also attended the Memorial Day Parade Committee. The parade is Saturday, May 27th, and we are still looking for speakers and parade marshals, and hopefully we'll have some names for our next meeting. And the letters of invitation for groups went out this week.
Thank you, Amy. Don?
Amy said it all.
She did. Okay. Thank you. Council comments? Any council comments? Amy?
The Wethersfield High School Drama Club is putting on Sister Act this weekend, March 10th and 11th. And don't forget, the Taste of Wethersfield is April 8th, and tickets are on sale for that.
Thank you. Michael, I mean Steve.
Go ahead, Mike, if you want.
Okay, I'll go. Okay, first thing, I support doing the field and hopefully getting it done as soon as possible for and financing it in a way that we can afford it. That's one thing. The other thing is the Hartford St. Patrick's Day Parade is on the 11th, this Saturday. Starts at 11 a.m. Wethersfield has a contingent. There'll be the police department, fire department, Griffith Academy. Mary Ellen Riley of Dance 10 will be one of our honorees. And Mary DeVersa from Mikey's Place will be another honoree. She'll come down and cheer them on in the parade. Usually there's about 50,000 people down there, and it's a good time. It might be cold, yeah, so you might have to bundle up.
There's only one solution to that, Mike, that I can think of. Other comments?
I also just wanted to say briefly, I also support getting the field done as soon as we can, obviously in a cost-effective way. But if you do look at the technology now, walk at any other field, it is significantly different, and it it's like walking on grass. It's a completely different feeling. And the field was great when it was put in, but it obviously is past its time, so it does need to be replaced. I also just wanted to commend the folks, particularly the students who came up and spoke. Not easy to do. I see Matthew Silver here, who I coached baseball a number of years ago, but it's a hard thing to do, and it takes some courage, and it's appreciated, and I'm sure everyone on the council appreciates that, and everyone did a great job. But again, it's an important issue that we have to address, and I think everyone up here recognizes that.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. Don?
Just, I do support refurbishing the field, replacing the field. I think that we have had those discussions, and the town manager did a very nice job at summarizing at the beginning of the meeting the activities and actions that have taken place over the course of time. It was discussed in regards to the timing of it coming forward, and we knew that it was going to be around this time that it was going to discussion would get really picked up and moving forward with it. It's a big nut to crack, and I agree with some of Mr. Young's comments in the financing. My husband said to me tonight, he remembers the minutes from the meeting when the field went in, that receipts were to go into account to put away, so at least there was money toward replacement of the field. And it would be, you know, I think that's important to remember. Nothing comes cheap, and we need to start saving for different replacements. We have CNEF funds that we use to do that, both on the board side and the town side, for capital projects and equipment.
Thank you, Donna. Anthony?
Like everybody else up here, I support replacing the field eventually. But I have to say, along with Donna's comments, I want some answers. If it was put out there that these receipts were going to be collected to pay for this field, I want to know what happened. I don't want to know where the money is. We can't just blindly make these promises and not follow up on them. So if the receipts were supposed to be collected for this very day, and we are now here, I want to know where the money is before I vote in favor of this. There's no bigger fan of sports than me, but I mean, we can't just make promises blindly. And I think we should get some answers before we take a vote on that. Thank you.
Thanks, Anthony. Council comments done? Okay. Jeff?
Peter's here to do a couple presentations. While they're setting up, I do want to answer the question on the Catone Field Fund, because that is a fund that we have used over time. When the town leases the field to outside groups, that money goes into a fund to do improvements on Catone. Now, that was exhausted when we built the lights. The lighting project exhausted those funds. And during the time of the high school renovation, we have closed the field to outside groups. So we've not rented that field to groups in about 4 years. So there's been no new activity from the town side into that fund. So that's where the town is. There's no funds in it because we used them for the lights and we've not rented it since. So, but Peter's going to talk about tourism. It's up to you. Huh? Joe, you would like to make a comment?
I wouldn't do that right now.
Hit the enter button.
How are you, Chris?
I'm good. How are you?
Nice to see you.
Chris Trazik. I am chairman of the Tourism Commission. Thank you for listening to us tonight, and I will apologize up front if I don't know how to use this laptop and advance the PowerPoint. So Tourism Commission actually is a few years behind in giving you an update on our activities, and we wanted to fill you in on everything that's been going on about marketing Wethersfield and making it a great community. So Tourism Commission was formed in 1999. It was a result of Wethersfield Weekend, and it's really designed to promote and encourage tourism, to make visitors to the New England area aware of our heritage and our historic and scenic sites. We coordinate a year-round calendar of events and promotions, and we assist in marketing any product promoting Wethersfield. We have several commission members. They represent the Chamber of Commerce, the Commission on Culture and Tourism, EDIC, the Shopkeepers Association. We have residents at large. We represent the business community and the historic organizations in town. Some of the programs that tourism does are our website and internet presence. We have a historic Wethersfield site, which is the primary place where people can come and learn about Wethersfield, what's available, what events are happening, and what our historic sites are. We distribute high-quality color print collateral. We have a marketing and media campaign. We do a lot with a really small budget. We have a website calendar of events. We produce a monthly newsletter that goes out not only through the Board of Education to all of the students in their backpack, but also to about 950 consistent people on a regular basis. We have information packets for potential visitors, and we partner with our stakeholders. We had 5 million impressions in 2016. That's a lot of impressions, people trying to find out about Wethersfield. We had more than 32,000 website visits. Surprisingly, or not surprisingly, most of those are now on mobile phones. So we are probably looking at having to upgrade the website a little bit. As I said, we produce the monthly e-newsletter, and we have a Facebook page. And just a reminder for those who aren't aware of it, like the Facebook page. Whenever an event is posted, please share it or comment on it. It gets it out to that many more people, so people are aware of it. We've also been able to use Facebook's very reasonable advertising to boost some of our events so that it hits more people, and it's done very well. We plan on doing it with Heritage Day, which is coming up in May. Some of the advertising we did last year was the Rhode Island Visitor Center. We are part of the Connecticut Digital Map, which is in most of the visitor centers. We have an iBrochure on Vacation Fun, and we did the Boston Globe Fall Travel Guide. Some of the news stories that were picked up last year included Holiday Doors of Connecticut, the 10 most beautiful towns in Connecticut, and we really should be number one, but we weren't quite there. The Boston Globe had an article in our fall travel issue. We were rated one of the top winter wonderlands in America and one of the prettiest winter villages in New England. And we also just recently had a fabulous article in Yankee Magazine, and you should have a copy in your folder. So just some of our promotional materials also in your folder are our spring and summer rack cards. We switched over to rack cards instead of the brochure. They're more cost effective, and they really lead people to the website. We use the CTM Media Group, who distributes those all across I-91, 84, and 95 corridor, and includes a number of hotels in Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts. We created a Heritage Walk brochure. We have our Living with History brochure, and we have information packages. And we recently put together a group tour package, which includes discounts and a lunch option, and it's a collaboration of the historic sites along with tourism. Just some additional projects that we've had. We've had our community photo contest for about 4 years now. Those photos are used in the town calendar every year. It's a great way to advertise what a great community Wethersfield is and some of the beautiful sites that we have. And we have an amazing group of talented residents who take those photos every year. It's really amazing. We have a really hard time deciding which ones we should use. We have the Wayfinding Signage Program, which we are hoping to finish up this year. We have our final phase, which is the last little piece of directional signage. We needed to have the intersection at Main and Church Street completed before we could finish that final phase of the signage program. We have a partnership with all of our stakeholders. We meet 3 and 4 times a year, talk about programs that are coming up. There have been a lot of collaborations that have come out of those stakeholder meetings. We've participated in the Discover New England Conference. This is a conference which is really for tour operators. We've been very lucky that the Connecticut River Valley Tourism District has hosted us and allowed us to share their space, and it gave us an opportunity to do one-on-one meetings, kind of speed dating with group tour operators, to talk about Wethersfield and encouraging them to come and visit us. We won't know the results of those for probably 3 or 4 years, because that's how far in advance they plan their activities. And we have been in conversations with the Hartford Bell about coming into the Cove and doing river cruises out of Wethersfield Cove on a regular basis. Just some other things. So going forward in 2017 and 2018, continuing to implement recommendations of the old Wethersfield Master Plan as we go forward, low cost implementation of collaborative marketing with our historic sites. We talked about the wayfinding signage. We are actually starting to work towards creating a more bike and pedestrian friendly community. We have a couple of people who have started a committee, and we are working with them to make Wethersfield more well known. We know that we have a lot of people who already walk and bike in the community, but we want everyone else to know that as well. And we are looking to improve the functionality of the website. And with that, I just want to say thank you so much for your continued support of the Tourism Commission. And your efforts that coincide with ours to promote the town and encourage people to come here, spend their dollars, which is good for our economy and good for our business's economy. And I'll answer any questions if anyone has any.
Chris, I'm sorry I don't remember, but how long have you been on the Tourism Commission?
A long time.
At least 10 years, right?
I actually think I came on shortly after it was formed, so maybe 2001. I wasn't one of the original commission members.
Right. Yeah. I just, you know, want to take the second to thank you for your work. I think, you know, I served on tourism. I think it was my first involvement back in town when I sat on the Tourism Commission, and I think you joined after that. But, you know, I think it's been so much more dynamic and visible in the efforts, and I'm sure you have a big part in that. You've had a very good year in terms of media publications, and I don't think that's an accident. I think it's because you've been working so diligently to get visibility, and the district is very, very much alive and vibrant, and people are coming in great numbers, much greater than they were even 5 or 6 years ago. And I think, and I'm sure I've shared this publicly before, but what's happening in the district is driving a lot of our economic engine. Mm-hmm. People are arriving in town and you know, spreading their dollars around the town, not just in the district when they come in, but you know, we're getting more and more vibrant. But I so appreciate the work you've done, and I've seen it both on the commission, but events when you've led. And I know you've gotten much more comfortable speaking publicly, you might add, than when you first did it. So I just want to thank you for all that. And those of you who have not seen the Yankee Magazine who just came out, it's a very, very good story about Wethersfield and captured some beautiful pictures of the district. So make sure I shared all that with you. Other questions or anything for Chris while she's here? Jody?
I was just curious, on the Heritage Walk, is that a self-guided tour at this point, or did you say that there are some groups that will
be
doing that?
It is a self-guided tour at this point. That's why we created the brochure. Mm-hmm. We do know that people who are at the Keeney Center can talk more about it, but it was fully intentioned to be a self-guided tour. It's about 3 miles total, and it's, I wouldn't say disjointed, but it's not easy to do necessarily all in one day. So part of it is also designed to encourage people to come back. Mm-hmm. And we do know that there's been a lot of really great feedback from people who have already seen it. I mean, any day that you are driving around Old Wethersfield, you see people stopping, reading the panels, talking about them. It's a great way to really educate the public about our history and our heritage and the fact that we were one of the first communities that really promoted preservation in the state of Connecticut. And that we were the leaders in that and in the forefront of that with the Webb Dean Stevens Museum. So it's a great opportunity for us to just really toot our own horn.
Thank you for that.
Any other questions or comments for Chris? Thank you so much for your report.
Welcome.
Great to see you as always.
Nice to see you.
Peter?
You want to just shut it down?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Deputy Mayor, Town Manager, and Councilors. You should have received in your packet a copy of my March 2017 Economic Development Report. There are about, as I tally them up, about 40 different projects in various stages of development that I wanted to bring to your attention. It's been a couple of months, I think, however, since I've been here, so the list is probably longer. Some of these projects are a little bit older, but in summary, we have 21 projects that were recently completed or new businesses that have come to town. So out of those 21, 10 are new businesses, 6 are facade improvement projects, and then I think the remaining 5 are either business expansions or businesses that relocated to new space here in town. So those are notable accomplishments over the last few months. In terms, if you have questions of any of those specifics, I'd be more than happy to talk about those. We are going to post the report on the town website for folks at home who want to know what's going on in town. In terms of projects that are under construction, there are 11 projects under construction right now in various stages in town. Several on the Silas Dean Highway, up on Ridge Road, the Ridge Road Development apartment building project is now underway. They got off to a little bit of a slow start. You may have also seen that United Paint was sold to Ring's End. They're probably going to be open within a month or two. Chipotle restaurant is coming to town at 1088 Silas Dean Highway. Progress is being made on the restaurant, the Great River Cafe at Putnam Park. We're meeting actually with them later this week to work out some of the construction details. There are 32 building lots under development in the south end of town between the Whippoorwill Way subdivision and the Back Lane Reservoir Estates subdivision. And then a couple projects that haven't started yet but have been approved by the town. Goodyear Tire has a new building expansion that they are hopefully going to start very shortly. And there's Caliban Ramen Restaurant, which is going to move into 1321 Silas Dean Highway. There are a couple of other projects, about seven projects that are in the pre-application review process, where they've sat down with staff and we've talked about the process and what they need to do to move the project forward. The most notable is the Lexington Partners property at the Fun Zone, which is to be named the Borden. It's a mixed-use residential apartment project, 120 residential units. There's a kitchen and bath showroom that's looking to move into the Berlin Turnpike. The gallery on Church, which is the name of the project proposed for the Clearinghouse Auction Gallery site. They are proposing to renovate the brick building in the front and try and historically match with a new building in the back. The total project there would be about 36 residential condominium units. A couple of restaurants are looking to go into various spaces in town. With that brief summary, I'd be more than happy to answer any specific questions you might have on any of those projects.
Mike?
Have we heard from the neighbors about the blasting that's going to take place on Ridge Road?
There's a meeting Thursday night with the fire marshal, I think here in council chambers, to talk about the specifics. It's going to be a controlled blast. It's going to be very limited in area. Part of the foundation, the borings indicated, as part of the lawsuit, if you remember, there was a lawsuit, they had to change the plans and they had to go a little bit deeper into the ground than they anticipated, but the neighbors have all been notified and invited to a meeting this week.
What time is that?
I think it's 7 o'clock, but don't quote me on that.
The council for Peter? No?
He's busy.
It was
reading.
A comprehensive list, which was good. It was nice to see.
Yeah, there's lots of good things happening in town, so it should be a very busy year from a business point of view and a tax base point of view.
Do they ever quantify for you how many jobs that might be created by someone coming in?
We try and do that, and we try and do it on a case-by-case basis, but we don't have a comprehensive list. It's something we've talked about, trying to do some follow-up after folks open to confirm some of those numbers, but it's probably something we need to put a little bit more effort into.
And even like when folks leave, don't they have to report that to the state?
No, when a business closes, they have to cancel out their trade name certificate, but they don't have to provide us with much more than that when they close. They have to do the normal things from a legal point of view to close, but so oftentimes we don't, unless anecdotally we know what's going on, we don't know exactly why some businesses close.
That would be interesting intel, just so that we know we're hitting the mark.
Right.
Just by way of comment, I know when I first got on the council, one of the areas, just northeast of here, actually, on Silasine, buildings had really been run down, and I'm glad to see the activity that's there now. Nice new buildings and renovations, too.
Yeah, I think there's maybe only two residential properties left on that stretch, slowly but surely, one after another. A couple of them have also taken advantage of the facade improvement program, which I can't stress enough how important a tool that is for us to help businesses like that.
Yeah, really a nice job. And I know you've worked hard on that. So,
thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Very much appreciate you coming out. Dolores, anything this evening?
No, I just want to remind everybody that there is a shred event on May 11th at the community center in association with the other senior events going on that day. It's 1 to 3 in the afternoon.
Thanks, Dolores. Jeff, you had something?
Yes, just one final point. On the podium tonight was a letter from the governor addressed to CCM that talks about the state budget process and how the state's probably going to have to pass some kind of comprehensive statute that basically overrides local charters when it comes to budget adoptions, because it's not anticipated that the state budget will be done by the time a majority, if not all, the local governments have to adopt a budget. So it's likely that even if we have to adopt by May for our budget purposes due to our charter, there'll be some relief in the state budget when it's adopted late May, June, that allows us to change it based upon what the local revenues and ECS funding does at the state level. So,
thank you, Jeff.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Okay, we'll move into council action. We have no resignations or appointments that I'm aware of, so we'll move into B2A. Can I get a motion on that?
Motion to approve the change order for Quisenberry Arcari that was approved by the WHS Building Committee.
Second.
Motion and a second, and I think some folks are here. Christine, you hiding somewhere over there? Nice to see you. Hi.
Hi, good evening.
I understand that this item was tabled at your last meeting for some additional information. So in your packet this evening, I understand that there's been a breakdown of the invoice. So any questions that I can answer for you, happy to do.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming out, Christine. It was helpful to get the breakdown that I think was sent over by the architects on this project. I was one of the folks on the council that had a question about it 2 weeks ago. So the detail on this was helpful in terms of this. And I think you have met since as well to finalize your request that this get moved forward, I assume, right? Or at least reinforced after looking at that, right?
Yes, at our last meeting. What is before you is expenditures that are projected through August for architectural services. We, of course, all hope that we are going to be done well before August, but Rusty's anticipating what those monthly reimbursement costs would be, so that's what's reflected here. So this is really an estimate. In addition to of fees for land use approvals, work that has been done to look at various remedies for site improvement at the school with the screens and being able to respond to the neighbors who have come to us, and we have had several meetings with them, one at the request of the Planning and Zoning Commission, and I believe some of those neighbors are here this evening. And then the cost for the plans that would have to be made after we go to Planning and Zoning and get approval to proceed. The recommendation of the committee, and again reinforced at our last meeting, is to do a partial screening of the roof, a shorter L screen, and partial landscaping. And we came to that resolution after the second meeting held here in chambers with the public. That meeting was facilitated by Peter Gillespie's staff for Planning and Zoning. Was attended by myself, the town manager, and other town and committee representatives. And we discussed this solution with neighbors that evening, and the committee then ratified it. So that's what the plan would be going to Planning and Zoning. Planning and Zoning, of course, has the final decision, but we trust that they will consider our recommendation seriously. There has been concern about penetrations in the roof. You will see the additional information that has been provided about the cost for that screen includes dunnage. So that would be building up on the roof. We would have fewer penetrations in that case. So I think the committee felt a little more comfortable proceeding. It's a little more money, but we feel that it's good prevention, so.
Thank you, Chris. Questions for Chris? Mike?
I had a question. You mentioned the neighbors. I see some of the neighbors out here. What did they have to say during that meeting? Were they good with that recommendation?
I believe so, okay. Yes, based on the outcome of the meeting. I wasn't here earlier to hear any earlier public comment.
There wasn't any.
Okay. We did have some neighbors attend our last building committee meeting as well. So, yep.
Other questions for Chris about this?
Jody? I just wanted to be clear. So what we're considering tonight was your recommendation for the architectural stuff on the partial screening and the partial landscaping?
Yes, these are his fees in addition to his reimbursement for his services. The PO has been expended at this point, so we need additional funds to be able to cover his cost to attend our meetings, mileage, etc.
So for this particular recommendation, all total is about $200,000, is that right, for the solution?
No, this evening it would just be for the architectural services. I believe that figure is not to exceed $36,000. Is that correct? Yes.
Right,
we just wanted to give you some additional information about what screening would cost. It has to go to Planning and Zoning for their approval.
I see. So that could change ultimately, the
$200,000. If Planning and Zoning wanted to have more screening, yes. More landscaping, Yes, and of course, this is not a hard number, but it's a very good estimate.
And where are you in the final total? Like, there's limited room for how much more can be spent, correct?
Correct. So we would have approximately $200,000 available to us. Is
yes,
that
after this was done?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So the neighbors do have a chance to come down to P&Z to talk again?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Yes.
Done.
I did, thank you. I did find this breakdown helpful. I know we had a lot of questions just based on the language from last time.
And I apologize, it was in our packet but didn't get into yours. So this information was available. We just didn't get it to you.
Well,
apologize.
Makes more sense when you see it broken down like this than it did. It's a lump sum. It was like,
I know, when I saw that figure, I said, no wonder they have questions. Yes.
All right, thank you.
Okay.
Echo, darling. Anything else? Okay, we have a motion and a second in front of us. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Abstention? Thank you. Thank you, Chris,
thank
for coming
you.
Down. I appreciate the detail. You can get that off your list of anxiety-producing pain. Yeah. 3A.
I'd like to make a motion to allocate $88,577 from the remaining balance in the health insurance self-insurance fund for payment of $88,577,000 of the Board of Ed's $312,000 required payment to the other post-employment benefit trust fund for fiscal year 16-17, with the understanding that the board has committed it will handle the remainder of the budget year within the current appropriation. That was a mouthful.
Very good. You have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff, you want to take this through this?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This is consistent. The Budget and Finance Committee met prior to this meeting and reviewed a possible supplement to the Board of Education's budget in order to gain compliance with the minimum budget requirement that we have to do. The solution is a allocation from the excess in the health insurance fund. As you know, we have a policy with the Board of Ed that certain funds in the health insurance fund at the end of the fiscal year can be transferred to the OPEB trust fund in order to build that up to offset our increasing liability for post-retirement benefits. The Board of Ed and the town annually budget for OPEB, for an OPEB transfer. This year, the Board of Ed has budgeted $312,000. What we are recommending is to allocate about $88,577 from that excess or from the remaining balance in that fund to be applied towards their $312,000 commitment. What that would do is free up $88,577 in the Board of Ed's general fund appropriation for other education-related expenses. Are you happy to answer any questions?
Questions from council for Jeff?
I have a comment.
Go ahead.
I watched the Board of Ed meeting the other night, and I thought it was kind of shameful that the Board of Ed was using the DECA students to come down here to resolve the issue. Board of Ed member Matt Forrest put a motion forward to fund DECA for $4,000, but the Board of Ed denied it. The Board of Ed should step up and give the $4,000 and not hold the kids hostage, knowing that we are working through the MBR and deficit issue with them.
Thank you, Mike. Other comments from Donna?
Thank you. I'm just a little bit sad to hear that in a $60 million budget that $4,000 has become an issue. I understand funding. I served on the board for many years. On council for many years and understand how that works. But it's one of the challenges we face as a councilor or a board member is trying to make things work. But $4,000 in a $60 million budget is not much. We'll work our way through the MBR solution as it goes forward. And I think that while we sit here, we're really responsive to the whole community not just the education portion of the town, and there's a number of other citizens that we need to take into consideration. And we're early in our budget process. We really haven't kicked that off. We're in the very beginning stages of that happening for this year, and we know we're going to be facing a number of different challenges from the state level back down to that's going to affect the local level. From the governor's budget, I can't imagine that what was put out there is going to be what the final will be. I just can't imagine that that's going to happen. And we'll be impacted, and we'll need to come back to the community and work with them. And it's not going to be easy. And I know we struggle and say that it's never going to be easy, but this has been listening to what could come down if teachers' pensions come down in an unfazed approach for the towns to have to handle. That's going to be a massive issue and will really cause taxes to increase for everyone. And it's really not something in our control because it's being pushed down from the top. So I just needed to make those comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Jody?
I just wanted to say that I do think it's unfortunate because I think that this issue was tackled last fall. There was a solution put on the table. I understand that it wasn't something that the board felt comfortable with. And so here we are 4 or 5 months later trying to solve the problem. And I'm hopeful that tonight we're going to have a resolution because we shouldn't have to count on somebody from the community standing up saying they're going to pay a $4,000 check so these kids can go to this program. It's sad. It's very sad. I understand getting cut mid-year by the state is a difficult pill to swallow, but that's why when we budget, we have to have our best guess estimates and, you know, have contingency in place and try to really work the numbers so that we're not fighting over $88,000. I think, you know, we're all smart people. We're on the same team. We're trying to do what's best for the community, and it shouldn't come down to this. So hopefully this is the last of it, and if we are blessed by getting more money from the state for education, then maybe we can team up together and get a new turf field.
Thank you, Jody. Other comments from council? Okay, everybody got their feelings out? Just a couple of things to be clear about before we move the motion. Wanted to make sure that folks that are out there that have been following it, particularly at the public level, understand the MBR piece. The MBR got on the screen, I think, back in November or December, because last year when we were finishing our appropriation, we were at risk in Wethersfield from losing some funds from the state during the budget process, which I think Jeff just alluded to. This correspondence from the mayor to governor rather talks about the timing. And we went back to the legislative session, myself and our delegation, and were able to move some additional funds into the ECS, which raised an additional amount of money to go into the fiscal year that we're in now for education. Frankly, we did not know at that time, wasn't shared with us, that that would require a recalibration of the MBR, which those of you who aren't familiar with it, it's the determination that if we do not fund our education system at or above its current level, with some qualifiers for enrollment and any extenuating circumstances which the district can provide if that's necessary, we are subject to having to replenish that. That came up on the screen this fall, and we became aware that Jeff got a letter because MBR and the ECS, the cost sharing, comes through on the town side. And we responded fairly quickly to that, met with our board chair and our finance chair on the board side, as well as our superintendent and finance manager, and crafted some approaches, which took a little time. So, this recalibration created a little bit of pain for us because, in truth, we funded more than last year. So I only share that because I think when folks come out and they look at what's happening as we go through, obviously, some things that have happened in the last 90 days with cuts in ECS as a result of the state's deficit. I heard somebody say, well, we shouldn't let politics interfere with what we're trying to achieve for our young adults. And I don't think anybody up here could agree more with that. I mean, none of our discussions
had anything to do with politics, I can assure you. Those discussions were forthright and candid. We obviously talked fairly regularly with the board about solutions. We also, through the delegation, were reaching out to the State Commission's Office for Education to see if we could have some dialogue about that MBR calibration, because frankly, we think it's a little odd that it's coming back when, in fact, we funded more, not less. But of course, on the heels of that, they cut ECS, so the state's kind of operating on both sides of their mouth with that. But at any rate, I want to say that I appreciate that the board members that we worked with, our chair and our finance chair on the board side, as well as Mr. Emmett and Matt, did communicate with us, and it was a little bumpy getting through to where we want to be. We do agree completely that we want to resolve this and get them through their deficit period. I know the deficit information is being provided online, and Bobby was kind enough to share some of that with me over the weekend. There is still a lot of moving parts in the board budget for this year, and more concerning for me as mayor is the potential, to echo Donna's point, of a lot of impacts in April, May, and June for the following year. Very concerned about that. I realize we're looking at little line items. We don't, by the way, don't have any appropriation capacity at council level for any line item on the board. That's entirely the authority of the board, and we trust they make those decisions thoughtfully. But I do want to say, for the benefit of parents who are worried about DECA, and we certainly learned a little bit about DECA in the last couple of weeks, but that's not information we had access to before this. But I want to be very candid with our parents and our residents. Brace yourself, because this spring is not going to be a pretty scene. We won't be talking about $4,000 line items. We'll be talking about tens of thousands of line items that are going to come back and make it very hard for us. There isn't anybody that sits at this dais, and I'm sure on the board, that takes their responsibilities with anything but full seriousness. But believe me, the state deficit is very, very frightening in terms of the impact on municipalities, and every day the story changes. So for the benefit of those who came and spoke, we appreciate that, of course. But I've been at this 12 years. This will be the toughest one for sure, and everybody up here knows it. So I don't want anybody to be misled about that. However, having said that, this is absolutely appropriate to get done. Take some of the relief off the board as they finish up grappling with their deficit through the year end, and we stand supportive with them. We have a motion, a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion passes. Thank you. And for the board members that came out, thank you for being here.
B. I make a motion to accept the proposal from Community Consulting for the 2017 Small Cities Community Development Block Grant.
Motion and second. Jeff.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. We are once again partnering with the Wethersfield Housing Authority in pursuit of a Small Cities Community Development Block Grant in the amount of about $800,000 to continue renovations to their various units. I think this one goes to the Devlin housing units. Part of the grant requires an administrator of the grant. We sent out RFPs to these companies that do grant administration. Two responded. We're recommending a committee made up of myself, Kate Forcier, the director of the Housing Authority, and finance director Michael O'Neill reviewed both RFPs and are recommending to the council to accept the proposal from Community Consulting.
Questions for Jeff on this? Pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. Okay. Motion and second front. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? Abstentions? Thank you. And finally, 4A, sweep street bid.
Motion to award catch basin and street sweeping bid to Wethersfield Sweeping Service.
Second.
Motion and second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Council, Sally Katz couldn't be here this evening. She's out of town. This is kind of a standard thing. After winter, we sweep the streets. Stormwater regulations, both federal and state, require catch basin cleaning and cleaning of areas that could discharge into streams and rivers. This is an annual type process we do. We're recommending Wethersfield Street Sweeping Service, which is the current vendor.
Questions for Jeff on this? Jeff, just one quick one. It doesn't seem like we're using as much sand. We've gone more with salt, and it looks like the roads are not bad. Has that impacted all the costs when they come in, or am I just seeing that wrong? It seems like we're not bad. The roads are fairly clean.
Yeah, we've gone to a straight salt mix, so you're really getting kind of debris, trash. The real money is in the catch basin cleaning.
Catch basin, sure.
That's what really is kind of the issue, because that discharges directly into drainage and storm and streams and so
forth. Which we have to pump out.
Yep. Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yep.
Questions, gang? Okay. Motion and second in front. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. I believe we have the no ordinances. Minutes of February 17th, please.
I'll make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of February 17th.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any changes, additions, deletions? Everybody's good. Okay. Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. Public comment? Gus?
Good evening. Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. After the February meeting that the mayor stated the following, quote, Mayor Montaneri had some parting comments with respect to Mr. Colantonio's stop sign and whether people are paying attention. At the request of council, the town manager provided an almost 10-year profile on this topic with full reports, and he feels council has been asked and answered and that more than a few times, and he would maintain or at least suggest that maybe he does not like our answer, but that does not mean we have not answered the question or that we don't care, end of quote.
That's a good quote, Gus, by the way. Thank you.
There is more coming. Yes, it's good. The only answer I received so far are as follows. There are too many stop signs in town, and we do not want to install any more. And there is not enough traffic to warrant the stop sign. I heard that before, more than once. Over the years, I have also asked why the stop sign in the westbound direction at Orchard Street does not have an additional sign alerting the driver that oncoming cars do not stop. The stop sign in the southbound direction on Walker Hill Road in the vicinity of D&D Market has a sign which alerts the driver that the coming cars do not stop. At Hartford Avenue and Main Street, a similar situation exists with the additional sign that alerts the driver that oncoming cars do not stop. Now I have to ask, how long do I wait before such a sign is installed on Morrison Avenue? The intersection of Walker Hill Road with Church and Nutt Street, controlled by a four-way stop sign, have an additional sign that say hallway. Like we need to know hallway. You can see those stop signs. Even though it is very clear that it's four-way stop, and yet I cannot get a sign alerting the traffic that oncoming traffic does not stop on my street. I also asked why signs are located in the back of the sidewalk and not between the sidewalk and the curb. East of Tifton, the signs are located between the curb and sidewalk, and west of Tifton, all the signs are located in the back of the sidewalk. The only reason or excuse I received so far is that signs are located in the back of the walk to minimize damage from snow plowing. My answer to that is slow down the speed of the snow plow. If that happens, I would have to remove snow on the walk one time per storm instead of multiple times, and the sign could be placed where they belong, with no impact to the post. As you can see, I have asked many questions that I have answer for. Another quote, the council does not have the authority to authorize the placement of any stop signs. By charter, the council does not have that power, and it is the state's prerogative to make that decision, and this report has been reviewed and examined by our local police with the state agencies. That was the other quote. The town charter, though, chapter 3, section 301, powers read as follows, quote, the governing body of the town shall be the council, which is you guys, so you can do anything you want, really, in town, which shall exercise and perform all the rights, powers, duties, and obligation of the town, except as the same may be assigned by the charter to some other officer, board, or agency. Now, I have a lot of contacts at the state. I have to say that maybe the mayor has been misinformed right here. I communicate with few state employees, and they made me aware that stop sign on local street are controlled by the local traffic authority, and any stop signs within state roads are controlled by the state traffic commission. For example, now on my street, the stop sign at the end of Morrison Avenue approaching Silas Dean Highway has the STC letters on the sign, STC, which stands for State Traffic Commission. And the stop sign on Morrison Avenue at Walker Hill Road have the note stating Wethersfield Traffic Authority. It's two different ones. I don't know if it makes a difference or what, but it seems to me one is the state and one is the local. The stop sign on Hillcrest Avenue and Orchard have the same note, Wethersfield Traffic Authority. And guess what? The stop sign on Morrison Avenue don't have anything at all, just a stop sign, just like one I have in my backyard. What does this mean? It means that the signs on local streets are controlled by the local traffic authority, and the signs within the state right-of-way are controlled by the state. Now I have to ask a new question. When the reconstruction of the intersection of Main Street and Church Street took place last year, two additional stop signs were installed at Main Street approach after the public expressed the desire to have a four-way stop. Did the town go to the state and ask permission to install the two additional stop signs? Maybe. Was a traffic engineering study prepared for this location? If it's the case, I would like to see one. The manual and uniform traffic control device, and as endorsed by the police report dated May 21st, 2009, states the following. A stop sign should not be installed on the major street unless justified by a traffic engineering study. If there is such study, I would like to review it. If it is okay with the town tomorrow, I will go by and, you know, the engineering office and ask to see a report. Another quote. I'm almost done. Hillcrest and side streets have a stop sign and is correct. It may not make a lot of sense why that has a stop sign and Morrison Avenue doesn't. He cannot go back 35 years and figure out what was at play when they put that stop sign there. But they don't make a practice of removing stop signs, and that would really only be the alternative when you look at the safety reports and materials provided by the state. I would like to see those reports too. What kind of answer is that, Mayor? Just because the stop signs have been there for a long time, that does not mean that you let them be. If they are not needed, remove them and save money for the town. After all, the town has stated that there are too many signs in town. Is it possible for me to see the safety report and materials provided by the state? Maybe, huh? The stop sign on Hillcrest Avenue do not have any safety issues, I have to say, with Morrison Avenue. The only thing that the stop signs at Hillcrest do is increase the amount of traffic on Morrison Avenue. Remember, the average daily traffic on Morrison Avenue is twice as the one on Hillcrest Avenue. As I have mentioned it before, the stop sign at Tifton is needed because the intersection side distance at this intersection is not safe for the posted speed, 25 miles per hour, and even worse for the 85th percentile of 31. Again, the police report prepared in 2009, it says that basically you have a stop sign in the westbound direction because you cannot see it. The intersectional side distance for that location is 290 feet. For Tifton Road at a 6% grade is 232. Now, can anybody explain to me why 290 feet you need a stop sign and 232 feet going down? You do not need a stop sign. The last quote I got, bear with me, thank you. Quote, but there is nothing that this elected body can do about that stop sign on Morrison Avenue. It is what it is, and in fact, the reports that were professionally presented by the town manager reiterate that there is not a safety issue on Morrison Avenue. The report, end quote, the report presented by the town managers was just a compilation of events for the past few years and nothing else, a waste of time, if you ask me. Never addressed the safety issue of the street after the reconstruction of the sidewalk. Remember that before the reconstruction of the sidewalk, there was no problem with the intersection's high distance. The town has created a problem. If something happens on that location, the town is liable for the consequences. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak this evening? Tom?
Please speak directly into the microphone. Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. I watched the Board of Ed meeting the other night, and from watching that, it's blatantly obvious. It's kind of the Board of Ed against the town council. You should have heard the conversations about this $88,000. Seems to me there should be a lot more cooperation between the two bodies. That leads me to talk about the football field a little bit. As I understand it, the football field was paid for by the town, not the Board of Ed. And the town staff maintains that football field. Yet they only collect revenues if it's a non-school event. There was some comments in the audience today about pay to play. Someone mentioned that they do pay to play in the high school and the other grades. I'm not sure of the cost, but assumably it's some nominal fee for a football player to play on the high school team. I think the Board of Ed should be partially responsible for maintaining that field, cost-wise. They have a $56 million budget last year. It's the majority of the town budget goes into education. Yet the town has to foot the bill. I'm all for high school sports. I think it's a great teaching experience for young people. Teamwork. They learn how to get along with the other governing body. But I think something's got to change here. There's just so much animosity between the Board of Ed and the town council. It was really pretty sad to watch. I think that there should be a way for the Board of Ed to work into their budget some of those costs for facilities. And one of the previous speakers mentioned, you know, you're spending this huge amount of money on education, yet there's 26,000 residents in town, and not all of them are taking benefits of that education. And I understand the concept. You know, I went to school, my parents paid for my schooling through taxes, and you know, you have to fund the school system to have a good solid town and raise people right. But you have to take a hard look at, you know, how much money is being allocated to one specific sport or one club or whatever, and you know, break it down. How much does it cost for the football players, the soccer players? I understand girls softball is going to be moved there now. You know, are you spending equal amounts of money on all the students for the chess club or whatever? I doubt it. It's heavily skewed towards athletics. And I think that needs to be considered when you go forward with the proven turf replacement. Probably not the popular thing to say, but somebody said that would be ridiculous to replace the field with real grass, but I don't know. Maybe that would have been a better way to go with a proper base. There's a lot of natural fields in the world that are played heavily with soccer or football or whatever. Something to think about. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Bob?
Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. Is this working better?
Sounds better.
What?
No good?
What?
Better?
What?
This thing. Is it working? Can you hear me? First of all, I think it would be nice, Mayor, and I've said this more than once, to have the town traffic commission look at Morrison Avenue and push to get a sign there to make that neighborhood safe. I think that would be a good thing to do, and it wouldn't cost very much money. Next, you had mentioned, Mayor, brace yourself for the budget for the state of Connecticut and what's and the ripple effects, that's what you meant, the ripple effects that are going to come from the state of Connecticut budget. And I agree, we have to brace ourselves. Unfortunately, we should have been bracing ourselves some time ago, because we all knew for a number of years these big deficits were coming. We knew. If you didn't know, you weren't listening to what I had to say. But also the newspapers said it too. And now it's a little, probably a little bit on the helter-skelter side, and all these folks that came out earlier today, you know, they just don't understand that there is a fiscal crisis going on. They've been brought up with, give them everything. Give them everything they want. Keep them happy, keep them quiet. And now as they're bigger, they want bigger and better things. And somehow they think that we owe it to them. We don't owe them anything. We give them a lot as it is. The Board of Education is extremely generous. You folks give them a huge amount of money to spend, one line item. You don't tell them how to spend it, and they spend it. The idea of the $4,000 that was spoke about earlier for the DECA group, and I think someone mentioned out of that $60 million budget, that's a shame that it even came to the table. It should have been taken care of out of a $60 million budget, not push it up here to the town council. Matter of fact, you folks should slap the hell out of the Board of Education for letting it slide up this high. If this was a business, Board of Directors, they wouldn't hear that. It would have been taken care of by the managers down in the bottom of the organization. Also, I mentioned to brace yourself. The manager tonight said that with the time that we have to have our budget prepared, and by the time the state of Connecticut has their budget prepared, there's quite a little difference there. And there could be relief to the town to change, relief to the town, you mentioned, Mayor, Mr. Manager. I don't know what you meant by that. I didn't know if you meant by we can change the budget revenue, we change the budget expenditures, depending, or are we stuck with the expenditures that you agree upon? Or, in my opinion, the budget should not be solid until we know directly from the state what we're going to get. Because if we get less, and again, when the state of Connecticut is closing down rest stops on our major highways, it's in the paper this morning, it was in Sunday's newspaper. Major rest stops are going to be closed. We've already had a couple smaller ones closed with porta pots, and I think some of these bigger ones are just going to put gates across, preventing trucks and cars and whatever else to go in there. We're looking at the teacher's pension issue. Nobody cared. And I'm really galled over the fact that now the state of Connecticut wants to push that pension out to the towns. The towns never cared when they went to negotiate contracts with their unions. They didn't give 2 cents what it cost because the state was paying for it. Totally irresponsible of our town Board of Ed and anybody that was negotiating contracts like that. Let someone else was paying it. You didn't care how you negotiated it, what you gave. Now it's coming back to bite us. And it's something to think about. And the taxpayers should be thinking about that, and the voters. Of all the people that sit up here, either on the board or on the town council, you didn't give two rats you know what about what it was costing for the pensions. Because the state was paying for it. And I don't understand why the state was paying for it.